go ahead.
Once there were 10 virgins, 5 foolish, 5 wise. They were waiting for the bridegroom to come so they could accompany him to the wedding feast. The wise virgins brought along extra oil in case the bridegroom took longer than expected, but the foolish virgins brought no extra oil. When the bridegroom did come, the foolish virgins had run out of oil, and so they asked their friends for the extra, but their friends didn't have enough to make it all the way back together. So when the foolish virgins had finally gone and bought more oil, they came to the wedding feast, but they were barred from entry because they hadn't been ready when the bridegroom came. Nowadays, science in the sky and a host of natural disasters have been seen as an indication by many that the end is fast approaching. But watch yourselves, and there will be signs in the sun and moon and stars and on the earth and distress of nations in perplexity because of the roaring of the sea and the waves, people fainting with fear and with foreboding of what is coming on the world. The powers of the heavens will be shaken, and then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, straighten up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. When talking about the end, it's important to take into account the context of the passages which talk about it, and how people in the past have viewed the end times, as well as how we should respond to the verses and their accompanying signs. To better understand this particular passage, it's important to look at the context. This was taken from Luke chapter 21. Luke, the writer of this gospel, was a doctor in the first century who spoke Greek, which was the common language of the time. He worked with Paul for a time, and being a doctor, he emphasized especially the times when Jesus would heal people. When he wrote the gospel, he took a lot of his information from his own investigation. He talked to people like Mary, the mother of Jesus, and Jesus' disciples, and it gave him kind of a unique angle on the story. The particular verse I just read is from Christ's own mouth after foretelling the destruction of Jerusalem, and it tells us what to expect when the end comes near and how we should respond to it. In order to properly understand our current situation, it's important to understand what people have thought about the end in ages past. Even before Christ's incarnation, you can draw a parallel between waiting for the promised Messiah and waiting for Christ's return. In Genesis 4:1, when Eve gives birth to Cain, many have interpreted the passage as saying that Eve thought that Cain would be the promised Messiah. And in more recent times, we've had people talking about the world ending, like in 2012, December, when the Mayan calendar ended, a lot of people thought that the world was going to end, but obviously, since we're still here, it didn't. One of the most popular things going on right now is the idea of a rogue planet in the solar system that will crash into Earth at some point. The most popular of these is called Nibiru. It was supposed to crash into Earth in 2005 and a couple of weeks ago, but we're still here. And every time it doesn't happen, they shift the date to a couple of years later. Personally, I saw a sign on a light post when I was in Boston this summer talking about how we should prepare for the end because there's this giant red planet approaching, which is obviously nonsense. You can find a short video on Nibiru on NASA's SSERVI website explaining the signs of why it can't be possible. So what we should take away from this is that we shouldn't set a date on the end. Matthew 24:36 says, "But concerning that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only." We would just be fooling ourselves if we tried to guess at the date. People have been wrong in the past about when the world would end, so it's important that we have a proper understanding of what will happen. One of the most common misunderstandings that people hold is the idea of the rapture, which is the false belief that we will be caught up into heaven for the tribulation, which is the suffering right before the end of the world. But actually, everyone will be raised at once on the last day. Another one of these misunderstandings is the idea of the millennium, and I have a handout that details. So there's only 6 copies of these, so you're going to have to share. You don't have to read them now, you can read them at a later time. Basically, the idea is that before the end comes, there will be a period of 1,000 years when Christ rules over the earth, and it's just Christians alive. So, how should we believe about the end? Well, the truth is, we don't know when the end will be, and when the end does come, we will know. The signs will be obvious, and there won't be a mistake. It doesn't matter when the end comes, even, only that we are ready. Luke chapter 21, 34 says, "But watch yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and cares of this life, and that day come upon you suddenly like a trap." This can be expanded to unbelievers as well. If they don't know when they're going to die, anything could happen to them. And so it's important that they don't leave any open ends in their life, that everything is closed, and they don't leave any of their dependents in a mire. So, whether it be Hurricane Irma or the solar eclipse, people jump at anything out of the ordinary to prove that the end is near. Though many have been wrong in the past, we can't ignore everything that's going on these days. If we do see these sign words laid out for us, we ought to do as Christ commands us. Straighten up and raise our heads, for our redemption is drawing near.
Thank you very much. Let's give him a round of applause. Thank you, Jonathan.